afternoon, everyone. Thank you all for coming. This is terrific. I'm really glad we moved this out of the library because last week we had 40 people in our library, if you've seen our library. I won't say that. I was going to make a very crass joke, but everybody was very up close and personal, let me just say. And some of you were there, so you have experienced that kumbaya moment from last week. On behalf of the Historical Society, we're so happy to have you here. I'm Liz Shapiro. I'm the director of the Historical Society. I think I know most of you. I just wanted to let you know that we'll invite you across the street up to the Historical Society immediately following the lecture for coffee and tea and some very nice cookies and things that you won't want to miss. So I would encourage you all to come and join us out there. That would be terrific. I also made Ed promise after he takes questions during the presentation that he would be booted out the door. Right, Mary? Escorted. So he runs across the street. So if you want to talk to him, you're not going to be allowed to waylay him here. You're going to have to make the journey. Because really that's the hook to get you across the street besides the great cookies. I don't have much to say about Ed Kirby. We've only known each other about 20 years, so our relationship is just beginning. I have traveled with Ed and Mary, so I can tell you those stories, but I'm not going to. They're personal and private to me. I asked his kids if they wanted to do an introduction. They firmly declined. And then Barclay Prindle earlier today told me a great story, but it's about Barclay, and I was going to attribute it to him. It involves Spurs and guns, and so I decided perhaps not the time or place. Spurs, yes. So I'm just going to let him take it away and fly with Amesville, Horatio Ames, and the Ames brothers.
Thank you very much. And a few other selected characters, because they're very key in this. I'd like to give you a little mindset on this to start with. Time, place, history. In terms of time, we're going to be pretty much in the, almost all, in the 19th century. And the 19th century was very developmental times, when you had the Industrial Revolution, which was much more successful in England than it was here. And it wasn't really a revolution, it was sort of a gradual growth. And you had a later industrial revolution also in the 1880s and so forth, which is also the Gilded Age. I'm not going to talk a lot about those, but think about the Gilded Age and the robber barons and things like that as we go along, and I think it'll help tie some of the things together. The place, well, the place is really the Upper Housatonic Watershed, which is also the Salisbury Iron District, which is also our Housatonic Heritage Area, so we sort of put all of those things together into a package. Then we're going to take some of that and see where some of these people go, because when we talk about the people are the more important things, not the products in this particular program that I'm doing, and some of the things that we found out. You'll see Lincoln in a few places in here, and if some of you have seen the film on Lincoln, there's a couple of things that I'll try and tie in as we go along. The film really wasn't about Lincoln. It was one part of Lincoln's life and really about the 13th Amendment more. But there's some tie-ins to the things that we'll talk about here as well. So we'll start with the Amesville group. The buttons on this side are about that size. My thumb is about that size. And so if I push the wrong one and you get another movie, why, we'll straighten it out. So far, nothing's happened. It's a little slow. There we go. This is put together really in terms of working with three groups, the Sharon Historical Society, which I'm sure you know about. Who's sponsoring it today, and also the Friends of the Beckley Furnace. We have a couple of members here of the Friends of Beckley Furnace, and we've been doing a lot of research on these characters that are pretty well known in this region, but actually we're very well known nationally and in some cases internationally as well, in the Housatonic Heritage Area. There it goes. That's the wrong way, so now we'll try the other button. Let's start off with the Ames family, because that's really what we're dealing with here. But the Oliver Ames, that you see up here in top, was the son of John Ames, and John Ames was from Easton, Massachusetts, up near Taunton, and those places up there where really the iron making got started in the colonies very early in the 1600s. Oliver Ames married Susan Angier, and they had this row of children that we have here. The ones that we're most interested in would be Oaks Ames, Horatio, and Oliver Ames Jr., and also William Leonard Ames down here. The name Leonard you see now and then. Leonard was probably the most famous iron making company in the south, at the eastern colonies of Massachusetts colony, and a lot of these people named their sons with either starting with Leonard Richardson, for example, who was the big man in Barnum and Richardson, gets the name Leonard from the Leonard family. It wasn't related, but they put the names in. So you see that occasionally as we go through. So Oaks Ames was the eldest. These were all huge men. Oliver Ames was a big man, very big. And as most of you that have seen the pictures of Ames with his cannon and so forth, realize how large he is. Whoops, we went twice there. There we go. Running down through here very quickly, William H. Barnum, we'll get to a little bit later on, but he was probably the most powerful man around here. He became a U.S. Senator and also the runner of the Barnum and Richardson Company. And then for the Union Pacific Railroad, not so much for the products here, but for the people that were involved. General Grenville Dodge, Thomas Clark Durant, Oaks Ames, and Oliver Ames Jr. And then for the Central Pacific Railroad, Collis Huntington and Mark Hopkins. They're part of the Big Four, as most you probably do remember. Those are two very separate systems that they had going for the Transcontinental Railroad. The Transcontinental Railroad was quite a thing when you think of it, and here's a country that's not even 100 years old that builds a railroad that goes all the way across a continent for a distance of almost 3,000 miles. Actually, it didn't make it, but we don't include that part with the history. Taking a look now at the yellow section that you see right in here is the upper Housatonic watershed, starting down here near Pawling, New York, in that area, and extending up here past Pittsfield and up into Lanesboro, Mass. There you have the three sources of the river. One starts over in here, the one that starts in Mud Pond. That's a nice name to start a river in the town of Washington up there, and then the one that starts in Richmond, and then one that starts up near Brody Ski Area and runs down into Lake Pontoosic. Interesting because of the structure of the area that you have the first two branches of the Housatonic start off by running north. So they're going north over here, north over here. Wood, wind was used some, but wood, water, and iron are the key things when we talk about this whole area. This was a heavily forested area. Iron was discovered in Salisbury and the Ore Hill area in Lakeville in 1731, and that's what really started the people coming into this area. In third grade, they tried to teach us that they came here first because to be farmers. Everybody was a farmer because that's how you survive, but nobody came to this area for farming until they got the kind of equipment in much later years that would make farming profitable. If you run through this area right along in here, this is in the Salisbury Iron District, this is the eastern edge of the Taconic Mountain Range. And the Taconic Mountain Range has between the Marble, which is right under this building here, and the hill that's right over by the ball field down in Sharon Valley, that area in between those in the contact zone is where most of the iron came from. And you'll find like if you go to some place like Ore Hill, which is over on this side, and then you cut through to the other side over just north of Billerton, you're probably getting the same iron ore in the beds that are in this side and the beds that are in that side. There also was, those were limonite and goethite irons. Over in this area in here, they had quite a bit of magnetite too, which was a much richer iron, but there wasn't nearly as much of it. Water was the key thing. The wood was there and the iron was there, so water was the key thing, and you had a series of different water wheels. You probably wouldn't believe these. I drew these myself. And the names on these are very impressive. It shows how smart these people were. If the water went under the wheel, they called it undershot. If the water went over the wheel, they called it overshot. And if the water came in about this high against the wheel, they called it a breast wheel. So those are how they were named. These two right here, most popular in this area. Because most of what we were dealing with in this area were little rivers. These were little river industries. In fact, the Ames factory that was on the Housatonic River is one of the few that were really on the Housatonic River, because the flooding often tore down everything that they built, so they used the little rivers instead. Eventually, they got into the tub-style wheels, and then they got into the turbines from there. You may have read in the paper that we're doing some work up at Beckley Furnace right now. We pulled the turbine up that was in place, and we're building a building over it, so that'll be one of our teaching tools that we have for the coming years up there. Looking again, you can see all the streams down here. All of these had little tributaries running off them, so there was plenty of water around, especially with the Berkshire Hills on this side, the Deconics on this side, and you have some pretty high hills in between and low water areas, so we had plenty of power. Interesting thing is that everything that runs out of the upper area right in here runs down by the Great Bend in the river, just south of the Bulls Bridge area in Kent. And everything in the lower area comes down in this area, and then it all flows in Long Island Sound from there. So that's what we're working with. Put this picture in the beginning because this is what the attraction really is. This is Horatio Ames right here with his cannon. That's the largest one. That cannon weighed 19,500 pounds, and he wound up selling to the government at 85 cents a pound. I never heard of things like that before, but he did well with that. He himself was quite a man. He was 6'6". He weighed 300 pounds.
And he talked a little squeaky voice.
He dressed that way and worked with the men. He was unusual in that factor because most of the people that we had, like Barnum, not Richardson, but Barnum and some of the Hollies, weren't really iron men. They were investors and they ran the business, but they weren't the people that were actually making the iron. Brilliant man, very great at technology, traveled abroad and to several other places in the eastern United States to learn more about the iron making process. And he was quite unusual in that way. He was successful for a while, and then later on was not successful. Even though he had a lot of smarts, he didn't deal with people very well. He was not a good businessman. He lost a lot in his business. He didn't even own that business, and you don't see this in the histories much. He didn't own that business at all until 1847. His father owned it. And his father was also a huge man. There's lots of stories about Horatio, but there's one story about his father was very irritated because he had to keep lending him money to keep this plant in operation. So his father came down and he said, "We're going to fight about this." And they walked up on Sugar Hill alone and had this huge battle with 2 6-foot-6 guys, 300 pounds. And they came back down, and none of them ever told what happened in the fight. There were a few bruises, so I guess it actually took place. But there are a lot more stories about them than that. Here is Mr. Ames himself, and he was the one that really controlled this. These people started off poor, but they eventually became millionaires. And it's really interesting, and this is a key that you'll see running through this whole program. The things that they made, that you wouldn't believe that they made as much money as they did on them, were shovels. That's a shovel, for some of you who've never seen anything like that before. And how do they make so much money on shovels? Well, we'll start off with the Erie Canal. 364 miles. Of the Erie Canal. That took some shovels. No bulldozers around then. This was before 1820 that was being built. You have then the California Gold Rush. Tremendous supply of shovels needed for that. Made a lot of other people, as you'll see in a moment, made them rich as well. Union Army. And then you had the Transcontinental Railroad. And then you had the expansion of the railroad. So these people that were dealing with shovels and shovels of many different types I won't show you all the shovels because we could kill a whole program just doing that, but Mark Frendel and I went to the research library out in California last year and in Sacramento and went through what they had in collections there. And the booklet that they had on the shovels is about this thick. And they made other tools as well, but the shovels were the key things. Horatio Ames not only raised some young people that were pretty smart people, he also taught them what to do and put them in places for jobs. Horatio hooked up with Leonard, notice the Leonard name again, Kinsley and John Eddy and Oliver Ames Jr., Oliver Ames Sr. sent them to Albany to start making products there, sell shovels, and start making some iron. And then that was not successful. William, the other brother, went to the Albany area and ran a blast furnace, and he did quite well and stayed in that area. So Eddie Ames and Kinsley acquired property in 1832, just above the present falls, the Great Falls. I don't know if you know, there were two falls there. There's the Great Falls and then Little Falls up above it. And the Little Falls were what they would be using for power. So they started the business here. Signs already that Horatio didn't get along well with a lot of people, because you'll notice here that Kinsley is out by 1834, Eddie is out by 1835. They just couldn't work with him. He was practically an impossible man to work with in that area. And he started all of his furnaces there, and he ran everything with wood fires to begin with. And the wood he had cut down up north in Massachusetts and floated down to Falls Village, and they had ropes across the stream to stop it, and getting the wood out of the water was, he lost some people. He had people killed working in that situation. So it was really a pretty tough situation. William H. Barnum, he was in contact with a lot of people. Most of what we read about William H. Barnum really deals with Lime Rock and with the Salisbury industry. But Barnum and Richardson, when he worked with Richardson, they eventually owned 8 furnaces in this area. But he also was making iron and in the iron business out in Michigan, and eventually wound up with some of the people down in West Virginia. So we'll see a little bit more of him as we go along. Few shots of the area up there that some of you may know well. If you don't, you want to take a ride up in this area. This is the Ensign Tavern, which was built in, 1744. So, and the taverns in those days were more like hotels and gathering places, and many of the people that came into the area did their business there. That's still existing, and this is what it looked like last December, just a little over a month ago. And the old shop that stood in that area, which was the store, and it was in kind of bad shape. This has nothing to do with the program, but I knew a guy that climbed up on this and snuck in the bedroom window there once. He's also resting on a couch over there now. You might want to talk to him afterwards. And it was quite nice now, and I noticed the other day they're still doing some additional work on that. So,
where is that?
That's right down by, the Amesville Bridge. Everybody knows the Amesville Bridge these days. It's just south of the bridge on the west side of the Housatonic River. Down a little bit further on the River Road, up a little bit further on River Road, is a house that was built by, Lamont Bradley. Lamont Bradley built a blast furnace in this area. The blast furnace is right down in here. He built this house where he could observe the what was going on in that area. And that house is still standing there. And Lamont Bradley had a blast furnace in there in 1812. So this house was built about the same time. And he sold that furnace to a couple of other guys that had a forge on the opposite side of the river, but he also, when Ames came into this area, he was able to supply him with pig iron. There we go. Residence of Horatio Ames. I can show you where that was located as we go along in this in a few minutes. just to give you a little idea of what went on in the iron business, most of the iron that was made here in the beginning, the first forge, these were called Catalan forges or Bloomery forges. These forges were made in, the first one was put in 1735 in Lime Rock by Thomas Lamb. And these made wrought iron, and in a day, maybe 5 or 6 hour period in a day, they could make about 350 pounds of iron. Now, iron is very heavy, so 350 pounds is not a lot of iron. Gradually we, this goes with the iron. This is the bellows. This is the upper side, and the bellows would be lifted up. The top would be lifted up, and these were leather flaps in there, so when you lift it up like that, they would drop down and the air would go in. Then it would slip off the wheel. There was a cog on the water wheel that was running it, probably a breast wheel in most of these, and it would slip off, and then there were heavy weights on it would push it down. So that pushed the air into, I'll go back to the other one again. It pushed the air into this in this area right over in here. So the iron ore was in this area. And once it was, this made the iron pulpy, it never melted it totally, and they'd bring it out and then run it through these huge helve hammers that would break it in down into shape and get the materials out of it, the slag out of it. We move then a little bit later on, 1762, to the blast furnace. This section wasn't on the earlier blast furnaces, but this would be a stack on the furnace about 30 feet high. When these started, they produced about roughly 9 tons of iron a day. That's quite a jump from 350 pounds. And by 1839, they put heaters on top of them and heated the air going into the blast, because you found that same way as you would with putting air into your fireplace, you found that if the air is warm that goes in, it cut down in the amount of charcoal that was needed and also speeded up the whole process. So the blast furnace of that, the blast furnace made cast iron. Cast iron, one of the faults of cast iron is that it's brittle. So that gave them a lot of problems. I'll figure these buttons out by the time we finish here. This is the list of the furnaces that were in the Upper Housatonic region. There's 43 or 44 of them all together. We found all of them, or found where they were. Some are standing, some is hardly anything left at all. But a couple of these, like West Cornwall furnace right here, and the Sharon Valley furnace right here, and then the where is it? Can't find the right one there. There's one other. Most of the iron that was used by Ames came from those furnaces, and they needed cast iron, and then they would change the cast iron into wrought iron. People have asked me, was there really a blast furnace at the falls? And this is down below the falls, and yes, it is, and it's right there, and you can go down and see it. You wouldn't know what to look at it, but here's the charging wall right up here, because that came on a bridge right over to the top of this pile here, which is the collapsed furnace, so it's still there. And you walk around that area, and then walk when the falls are dry, you can find where a lot of these things were anchored into the into the areas up there, where the race ran down to power the breast wheel that ran the furnace and so forth. So there's a lot there to be seen.
I'm sorry, can you repeat that?
Can I what?
Can you repeat that? Was
the
that
whole thing?
No.
I like the water part. Oh, no. You didn't want that part?
No, because I walk there all the time.
Okay.
Did you say that was a blast furnace?
Yes, that was a blast furnace.
So what does that mean?
A blast furnace, it means...
They put in slack. Wait, did they put in...
I got to go back to it. There it is. It was there for a while. Yes, they loaded this from the top. They put in iron ore.
Yeah.
They put in charcoal. And they put in lime, which
right next to the river there.
It's right next to the river, okay. Right there. But it's not there. I mean, all you can see is just a pile of materials that's collapsed.
So wait, I'm sorry. So, but the structure is still there, but you can't see it. All.
It's under there, but it's
under
collapsed.
There. Okay, that answers my question.
Don't dig it up. Let me get back on track here.
Sorry.
Now. Percent of carbon, if you'll notice right here that in pig iron, because pig iron is brittle, it's brittle because it has a high content of iron in it. Wrought iron works a lot better in a lot of these things, but the problem is that when you're using those forges and you're making 350 pounds a day, you're not making very much iron, so it takes a lot of work to get it. So what he did was to develop a furnace, which you'll see in just a moment, a furnace type, which heated the iron to a very high temperature without contacting the fuel. And so when the carbon is in contact with the fuel, that's what causes the problems. One of the other things in the manganese that you see there reacted just the opposite way. It made pig iron, the local pig iron, very useful in terms of shock resistance. So you get the shock resistance from it. So very good for cannons, very good for railroad car wheels, and things of that type. This is the type of furnace that the first one that was put in this country was put in actually by Horatio Ames. Nobody had done one in the United States before this. Here's the heating area over in here. These were huge stacks of wood that he had. And this would supply the heat, both the hot gases and the radiant heat. And this was the iron that was pig iron that would be put over on this side. And then he would get that and get that pig iron really heated up. And then they would work on it in this type of furnace, which was called a puddling furnace, and make the iron in that way. This is a cross section of it. This is the fire area in here. This is where the iron is. This little opening right over in here, you raise this, it's on the opposite side, and that's where the puddler works on the iron. It'd be a puddler and an assistant, yes.
Ed, I guess what you're saying is iron in its natural state contains all sorts of different chemicals that you want to get rid of. Is that correct?
Correct.
And then if you heat it up high enough, you'll get rid of, or you get rid of not all, but most of it is different.
The trouble is with cast iron, you didn't get rid of the carbon.
So
the carbon, we're not going to have a carbon problem here because the carbon is in the fire over here and goes off as carbon dioxide, and over in here is where the iron is that's heated hot enough to melt.
And what happens to the other elements?
Most of them go as gases. A lot of them form into the silicon forms with oxygen, forming slag. So the slag that you see everywhere, which are tons and tons of slag around. At the Beckley furnace, for example, there are 8 acres of slag, most of it about 70 feet high, which is about equal to the amount of iron that that furnace made, which is kind of interesting.
And when all these gases escape, were they bad for health?
They make a lot of press today. They didn't pay much attention to that kind of thing. Those were really unhealthy areas. The charcoal is more of a problem than some of the things because the charcoal being burned on the hills forms a heavy smoke and a heavy gas which slides down into the stream areas so where the people were living. So the charcoal probably did more damage than anything else. And you also have the fact that the people working on these things are undergoing tremendous heat. Can you imagine the effect that would have on the eyes and things like that? And so, yes, there were health problems. A key in this thing right here is the stack. Those are about 40 feet high, so you'd have a tremendous draft on this. Ed, you have a question?
Yeah. Where did the initial design of the furnace come from? England? In other words, they just...
The initial design of the forge, is a Catalan forge, comes from 8th century Spain. The others come from England and Germany, probably about 14th century. So they go back quite a way.
Except for this, which was Horatio's design.
This was Horatio's, it came out of England, 1775. But no one was using it yet over here. These guys, these puddlers, were very special kind of people. First of all, there weren't many of them. And he puts in 10 puddling furnaces. Each one of those furnaces uses about 600 pounds of ore for each run-through, and they could probably do 5 run-throughs in a day. So you're going to be producing over 2,000 pounds of iron. The same kind of iron that you made in the old forges, except now you have a lot of it. And that's the secret he really had. They're working these balls. You notice the loop panels they have right here, and they have these long, those are about 8 feet long. They weigh 23 pounds. So right away, you got to have guys that have some very basic strength. They also, I know you won't believe this, they were big drinkers. In the days that Horatio was away, they often didn't show up to work for work. And if he talked to them too much in a bad way, which he often did, they'd just leave because they could always get a job someplace else. Other plumbing furnaces did eventually open up in this area. So they could just leave, and that was it. So he took care of them very well and found that if he didn't keep them, of course, his business wasn't going to be nearly as good. There's another one of the puddlers working here. So from that, you get Puddler's Lane, and he put in nice houses, Greek revivals. Those houses are mostly 1820s and 30s, I think, in that area. And there's a series of them, as you've probably all seen. Quite nice, some of them, a lot of them still standing. And you'll find some of those also in Lime Rock that were for the iron workers. The ones in Lime Rock that were like that, the iron workers that worked there probably were making any place from $1 to $1.15 a day, but they rented those houses for $3 a month. You try and do that ratio today, and you can't do that.
A question.
Yes.
The photos that you had of the puddlers, what year was that photo taken?
Those puddlers in there are a little bit later than the ones, because we don't have any pictures of puddlers that were there. Those would be probably in the 1880s, 1890s, when it's still being used a great deal. Notice the wood stacks here. This is the Ames factory. There was the railroad came across the stream, and if you walk around and when the water isn't flowing over the falls, you can still find the places where they had that railroad anchored there. It was right just below the present dam that's in there. You got two for one there. Very quickly through this, I'm not going to give you a chance to read all of it, but this is looking at Horatio Ames in the 1850s. After having a lot of trouble by the 1850s, things are going real well. Notice the dam across the Little Falls, so the railroad was there. The main shop was 268 feet long. He had water-powered turbines, which is, this is pretty heavy horsepower for those days in the turbines. He had 10 wood puddling furnaces, so he had 10 of those all together. And he had his biggest hammer, which he took great pride in, was named Thor, god of thunder and lightning, with a 6-ton head and a 5-foot fall. That's it. It's lifted up by cogs on the water wheel, and then it would drop it from a height of about like this. And that was used for shaping the iron that they took out. Notice that he had 300 workers all together. Now I got to tell you a little story on this. Lou Bucherri did a program a couple years ago at Tuesdays at 6. A great show on this, and it was very well done. His approach is a little bit different than mine, but he mentioned that there were 800 workers there, and I said, where did Lou get that? So I looked all over, and so I finally looked in my book, and it says 800 workers. I wrote the damn thing, but it was wrong. Exactly 300. So now that ruined my life, I'm wondering where I got it. And I got it out of Chard Power Smith. And Chard Power Smith's book on the Housatonic, which is an excellent book, does have some errors in it, and that's one of them. This figure is out of Gordon Gaylor and Chemish's book. And I think they've done the best job, and they went through all the records on this, and I'm sure that one is correct. Well, everything was fine, and then came 1856, and the iron business slowed down. A lot of our local furnaces actually went out of business, if you check them, at that time, and then there was a panic in 1857. So that did slow things down considerably. This is a map. This is from Gordon and Gaylor and Chemish. This is the dotted lines here are the later Housatonic railroad shops. But these are the shops that he had in there. This A right here, that's his house. You saw a picture of the house before. That's no longer there. These that have D in there, D for dwelling, where it says D4, that means there were four separate apartments in that building. you find the foundations of these right along the road. This is the present dam down here, which wouldn't have been in at this point. And the B is for barns. You got barns and sheds all over here. Notice the rock bluff up in here. You can still see that quite clearly. Mm-hmm. And the flume that's over here, you can see where it actually ran, although the flume itself would have been much higher. This water was stopped by the Little Falls, which we don't have a lot of information on, but it looks to me like it was about 15 feet high. So that would give 15 feet of head, which would give you good water power. And that ran off on this to run water wheels in the interior of the building. Now we get to a slightly different spot now where Ames, when the railroad business is dropping off some, gets the idea that he wants to go into the cannon business. And you saw the cannon in the beginning, but this is the older style cannon, which most of these are made of cast iron. The problem with these is if you overcharge them, they blow up. And if you blow up a cannon, it's not going to hurt somebody down the road. It's going to wipe out the people that are standing right there because it's just shrapnel fills the air when something like that would blow. Some of the cannon men at the beginning of the Civil War, Dahlgren and Perot, both made cannons. It's interesting. They're both in the service. They both make cannons. And whose cannons are they buying? Well, they're buying Dahlgren's and Perot's. So now Ames tries to break into that business, and he had a great deal of difficulty. And Dahlgren made his cannons thicker back in here. He kept making them larger. Bronze cannons were much more successful. If they blew up, they didn't shatter, but they were much more expensive. So Ames then gets in the cannon business, and he goes to Lincoln over this, and he talked to Abraham Lincoln about it. They were friends with Lincoln, but so was Dahlgren was a good friend of Lincoln, so that didn't help his case much. And he went to see Lincoln twice. He went to see him, his father was already good friends with Lincoln, and he went to see him in 1863. And this is the letter, not the actual one, of course, but the letter that Lincoln wrote back. I'll read some parts out of it. This was written by, Lincoln had two secretaries. One was a guy by the name of Hay, John Hay, and the other one was Nicole. And Nicole, also tied into our area, was a Pittsfield man. So he came from the Salisbury iron area as well. And you can't see this well here, but he wrote it, and then Lincoln penned in some things. He penned in Falls Village, Connecticut, and he penned in the date and the year. So I'll just read you some parts of this. To Horatio Ames, this is from the Executive Mansion in Washington, and it's to Horatio Ames, Falls Village, Connecticut, September 28, 1863. So you're well into the Civil War at this point. If you will honor before the first day of March, 1864, he's given him more than a year, within the state of Connecticut or at any point near this city, produce guns, each of a capacity to carry a missile of at least 100 pounds weight and notify me thereof, I will cause some person or persons to examine and test said guns. And if, incidentally, this is, the whole letter is one sentence, he used a lot of commas. if on such examination and test it shall be in the opinion of such person or persons, that said guns or any of them are on the whole better guns, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, then we'll buy them. But I like the part down here, at the rate of 85 cents a pound weight of said guns so accepted, it being understood that I have no public money at my control with which I could make such payment absolutely. Yours, et cetera, A. Lincoln. He signed the letter on that, which I thought was kind of an interesting thing. And so this caused the guns to be tested. They did sell the 7.5-inch guns, which are much smaller. They sold about 13 of those with no problem. Then they bring in the great big one, and they don't have the same kind of luck with that. The testing of the guns is done by some guy named Dahlgren. That sounds familiar, doesn't it? He tested one of those guns through 1,600 firings. Now, it would seem to me that it would take the whole war to fire 1,600 times, but he actually went through 1,600 firings, and he did find a couple, when they finally took an order on it, he found a couple they had some problems with, so the whole thing got held up. This is the, this is a copy of his patent here, and this is in 18, I can't quite read it. Well, it was 1864 anyway, so it's getting down to, if you know when the Civil War ends, you see that he's already in some trouble with this. And he also, this is the new one that he put out. This was making ordinance. And these are all separate sections right in here. And what he did was he made all of those, and they had to be cut perfectly. And then he had a tube that fit inside them, like this right here, which was a steel tube that fit all the way down inside. Up till now, all these cannons were made by, you make the cannon out of cast iron and then drill it. And that was started, in fact, the first cannons that were made in Lakeville during the Revolution. And it took forever to drill some of those, and the drill holes weren't always straight, so when they tested them, they put a little tag on it, shoots 3 degrees left, shoots 3 degrees right, whatever, and they leave the tag right on them. So they had to put all these pieces together. They were welds, but they didn't weld with welding irons the way they weld today. They just welded through heat. So it was very difficult to put all these together. Yes?
Yeah. Does the Hotchkiss cannon have anything to do with any of this kind of what you're talking about now?
No.
No, nothing.
No, the Hotchkiss cannons...
Much later?
No, it was made, the cannon was perfected in the 1850s.
Oh.
And the cannon, particular ones they were using, was exploding shell. These do not have an exploding shell.
Oh.
Of course, you got something that weighs 125 pounds coming at you. Whether it explodes or not doesn't make too much difference, I don't think. But this is the assembly of it and everything, and what happened, of course, was that the war ended. So it made quite a difference in the whole situation. He test fired the cannons in from Falls Village over to Salisbury, over to the Amesville side. And I looked it up in the records, and Ames owned no land on the Falls Village side. So they must have just walked up and said, hey, okay, we got this cannon, we want to shoot across there. And they had a guy that drew this that actually worked with them. This is very old and it's very hard to see. This is the area, if you go up about 0.2 miles past the cannon, or past the falls, and there's a house in that area now. But this is the area where they fired the cannon into. And they were fired in this area, and you can see by this map over here, this is east and this is west. So they're shooting from the Falls Village side of the river over here, across the river and into this bank. And they tested them there. And one of the things I read, it said it sort of brought the war home to the Great Falls area, because people could hear the cannons going off all day long, which must have been fairly exciting. You stay off that road. And we move into another character. This guy's from Lee, Massachusetts, Salisbury Iron District. And his name, I forgot his name. What's his name? Huh?
Durant.
He was born of a very wealthy family in Lee, Massachusetts. And he went to local private schools and some schools in New York, and then went to Albany Medical School, where he earned the title of doctor. And was called doctor or doc for the rest of his life. But instead of going into the medical field, he went into business with his uncle, who was in the business of transporting cotton and things like that. And transportation, now you get into this period in time in the 19th century, was a key thing. And he was one of the biggest crooks around. He had a couple of railroads that he set up, and he had the M&M Railroad, Mississippi and Missouri Railroad, and in this railroad, he built a bridge across the Mississippi River, and one of the river boats that was traveling on the river after the bridge was up ran into it and sued him. So he was faced with a lawsuit, and he hired a young lawyer, I can't recall his name, some of you may recognize him, and I didn't know until I got into this how big he was actually with the Lincoln was with the railroads. I mean, he believed in this very strongly. The first time he ran for president, that was part of his platform, was completing the Transcontinental Railroad. That was also a big factor because the South wanted the Transcontinental Railroad to go through the South, where the Southern Pacific eventually went. So this was really a key thing. So he hired Lincoln, and this is another thing I found out. This was just fun doing research like this. And because I would have liked Lincoln, because I like trains too. So Lincoln is gets elected, and he lives in Springfield, Illinois, and he has to go for the inauguration to Washington, so he takes a train. He drove the train part way. I never knew that. I found that in one of the references. They let him be engineer for a while. I couldn't find any more about it, how far he drove it or anything else, but I think that's great that Lincoln actually drove his own train, and if Obama hears that, he'll probably want to do it too. In 1862, when the whole concept of the railroad was improved, all these land grants started coming in. These are not railroads, these are land grants for the railroads. And if you look at the comparative size of some of these, you know, that's more than 10 miles wide in a lot of cases. So railroads made out very good on some of this stuff. Because they're getting the land, they can do mining there, can do other things as well, which are a lot of problems with this later. But what they were starting to do was to start from Council Bluffs, Iowa, which is right there. And Council Bluffs is right across the river from Omaha. And so the railroad was supposed to start. You already have railroads coming out here. One of the railroads that started right in here was started by, I forgot his name too. I'll think of it. Anyway, the town clerk, Mrs. Wheeler's brother, the town clerk, Ogden, right. The four names of Ogden, right. And Ogden was one of the ones that helped get the railroads in this area in here. So you had railroads coming all through this area already in this period of time. So this is where the start goes. This is Promontory Point right here. This is the Central Pacific Railroad, which was shorter than the Union Pacific part of it. But also you had to go through the Sierra Mountains, which is a very tough part of that. But this is this caused a lot of problems, but this area right in here was where it was supposed to start. Lincoln went there when he was still a lawyer, 1857, and again in 1859, bought property there and was later accused of wanting to start it there because he owned property there and he'd be able to sell it. As it turned out, he sold the property before that, but there's still articles in some of the old newspapers that tell that Lincoln was pulling a fast one on some of this because he still had some connections with that. So that's where this was set up, and a lot of these were put in and never got railroads, but some did get railroads, and they were put in because your congressman said you need a railroad there, so we'll put one in. And there's a place right in here, and this one right next, just 34 miles north of Des Moines, which is called Ames, Iowa. Guess who it's named after? Oaks Ames, who was one of the congressmen that would be very active in this. Lincoln, by this time, is president, and when it comes time, he had done all this work on the original bridge situation that was knocked down. So who do you think he selects to run the railroad system for the Union Pacific? You got to guess. I can't remember his name.
Durant.
I was faking it. You know, you put it out there. So I do have trouble with names. You've probably already figured that out. Anyway, so he hires Durant. And Durant now, instead of just working with the government and the Union Pacific Railroad, he forms a new company called Credit Mobilia. And Credit Mobilia is they take in the money and then they pay Union Pacific to build the railroad. Now, I feel bad for Butch Cassidy. When Butch Cassidy and a Sundance Kid robbed the first Union Pacific Railroad train that they robbed, they got $30,000. This guy, Durant, is getting these, he's billing, Credit Mobilia is billing the government $60,000 per mile, and he's paying $30,000 per mile to the Union Pacific. And by the time they finished the Union Pacific, it was almost bankrupt because they spent so much of the money. Meanwhile, Credit Mobilia is doing very well, and it starts getting sold to a lot of different people, which is going to lead to a rather sizable scandal. This guy here is not really that small, but if you blow this picture up, it loses its character. This was known as Crazy Judah. And Judah was a man that lived down in Bridgeport, was an engineer, surveyor actually, and he claimed he could survey a line that ran through, that would go through the Sierra Mountains, and he did, and that's the same line that's still used right now. You can go through it on the California Flyer, and you go through that whole section that he designed there. So he was from Connecticut and pretty outstanding person. Now we're down to Oaks Ames. After 2 years, only 2.5 miles have been developed on the Union Pacific Railroad. Meanwhile, these other guys are working through the Sierra Mountains and they're doing okay. So Lincoln Fires, the first guy who I've forgotten again, and Durian. You're going to learn that. I have that trouble all the time, so this is nothing to do with the show. So now he hires
Oaks Ames,
Ohio, but he's really of Massachusetts, and who also spent a lot of time down at the Ames plant in Falls Village. But he hired him, and now he not only takes over the whole project, he takes over Credit Mobilia. And he's got a whole new cast because he's in Congress. And he finds that some of these congressmen actually are interested in investing into this as well. So the trouble increases as we go along. Now we shift to the other railroad, and which was operated much more efficiently. The big four included Crocker, Stanford, this guy right here, Huntington, and Mark Hopkins. Actually, there were two Crockers involved in this, so if you go to the Crocker resort out in Sacramento, it talks about the big five and not the big four, and I think with pretty good reason. C.B. Huntington was born in Harwinton, Connecticut, became one of the richest men in the world, and he was born in Poverty Hollow in Harwinton. Mary and I drove down to Poverty Hollow, and it looks like Poverty Hollow. It's still sort of in the south end of Harwinton, down in a very heavily wooded and glaciated area. And they were so poor that the first selectman took he and his brother out of the house that they lived in and put them on a farm. And then they worked on that farm and finally started going into business together. Now he eventually, in 1871, is going to wind up in business with William H. Barnum. But it's bothered me because there's a lot of things that indicate to me that he was here long before that. And I tried to figure out why he'd come. He was very interested in trains, and the railroad was completed through Falls Village area in 1841. And I think that's the time that he was first there. But I still couldn't really pin it down until I checked his records a little bit more and found that there was a young woman by the name of Elizabeth Stoddard who lived in West Cornwall, just about a mile up from the elementary school in West Cornwall. And whether that's what brought him there, but that's what kept him there. And that was 1841, and he was around, and they got married. They had a fairly long courtship, and they got married in 1844. And he winds up then, after being in business around here, in Oneonta, New York, he winds up in California. And the other character, Mark Hopkins, was born, he was the only one that was born a little bit further from here, but he was of a Great Barrington family. The Hopkins family was very, very important in that town. And he came back and spent quite a bit of time there. He finally married a girl by the name of Mary Frances Sherwood, and who was a member of the Kellogg family there. He was also a Kellogg. In fact, they were first cousins. You don't have to go far for a wedding like that. So he married her, went west a couple times, and then came back and brought her out to the west as well. So now we've got those two characters out there, and they go into the hardware business. And it becomes quite a business. This building over here, that's the Central Pacific Railroad office right there. Huntington and Hopkins. The buildings are still there. They moved them from their original location. They were separated. And this is right in old Sacramento right now. And I'll give you one guess as to what the biggest seller was.
Shovels.
Shovels, of course. There you go. Right back to the shovels again. In 1 year, these guys, even before the gold rush, in 1 year, the company made something like I think it was 78,000 shovels altogether. 65 men made 78,000 shovels. And they made a lot of other tools as well. So they hooked up with Sanford and hooked up with Cracker. Hopkins became the financier behind it. He kept track of all the records and everything else, and he was really brilliant in that respect. But these men operated much more efficiently than the people that were doing the Union Pacific. But that still didn't get rid of our old friend right here. I forgot his name again. And this is just before the railroad was finished. They took his picture out there, and this is just before the completion of the railroad. He was so tied into it that when he heard that Stanford was going to drive a golden spike, he went and he drilled a hole in one of the ties so he could drive a spike in there himself. So he actually, after everybody was gone, went and drove a spike in. He lasted a long time because he'd never gotten any trouble over any of this. And the railroad was completed. That was Sparky Prentice in his younger days up there. Learned another thing that I didn't know about, when you look at the differences in the stack, and I've always seen those are the coal-burning engines, and these are the wood-burning engines. And because you got the wood sparks coming up in here, there's a sieve, sort of a screen area right in there, so it stopped the particles from going out and setting the surrounding territory on fire and just dropped back down again. You'll see stories of where there were 30,000 people for this and everything else. There was somewhere between 500 and 800 altogether. This is a pretty isolated place. When they started advertising Omaha to San Francisco, I thought it was going to be Council Bluffs. What they did on this, instead of starting to Council Bluffs, you'd take a train to Council Bluffs, and your train would be put on a ferry and taken over to Omaha, which was kind of a delay, and then on to San Francisco. And it never did get to San Francisco because the railroad started going east from Sacramento. So it was a little while before the railroad got a little bit further down there, but it's got all these nice things that can happen when you're traveling, Pullman cars and all of that. But they've taken something now that'll take people across the country in a period of 6 to 8 days, where it used to take them months to get across the country. So it's quite a change in that. Going back here again, so now we're starting right here. The railroad was completed in 1869, but it really wasn't completed. And they wound up by going down here and bringing the railroad through Denver and then up to Cheyenne and across that way where it goes down. This part of the railroad is still essentially the same place. But it stopped right in here, where in Sacramento. It never did get down here. It came down and then now it goes down the coast all the way to San Diego. But the railroad goes to Oakland, Emeryville, which is in the Oakland area. And Frank Sprague of Sharon electrified the railroad that was in here. That you may have seen in some of the things that we've written about this. 1871, a real critical time in this period. Ensign Manufacturing Company, Ensign out of Lime Rock and the Ensign family, and also in Amesville, and William H. Barnum. William H. Barnum actually becomes president of this, so he's tied up pretty much with that. And this is a picture of the factory. This produced thousands of railroad car wheels along with what they already had, so they became a very big producer, although you don't see them in history as big producers because they really operated as so many separate countries. Now, in 1871, Horatio Ames died. It killed him, the whole cannon business, because he changed all his materials over to developing cannons and then wound up with no cannon, not making any money at all. And he died in Amesville. And the Housatonic Railroad bought this and put the railroad shops in there. They had a roundhouse in there. And there was already a bridge across the river so they could come through. Now you're looking at the buildings you just saw, these right in here. And behind that was the turntable and the roundhouse so they could bring the engine in. The idea of this was having a shop that was roughly halfway, not truly halfway, but some way halfway between Bridgeport, which is the south, and Pittsfield, which is the north. And so that, then that operated there for some time. Let me just back up one on that one. If you look at this one over in here, you can see these rocks in here in this area, and then the flume area was up in here. Of course, none of that is there today, but the rock bluff is still in there. And if you walk along the road right in here, you can still find the foundations of all these houses. Lou, I'm sure you've done that 100 times or more.
You can actually still see the remnants of the brick wall that was the...
Yes, yes, you can see that.
The round area.
These are the some of the workers at the Housatonic area. Notice, kids, a couple places in here. It is not bring your son to work day or anything like that. These kids, if they were there, they had jobs to do, and some of them worked, worked 10 hours a day. They were used a great deal, even once they were 10 or 11 years old. Now, Credit Mobilia, when it comes time for the 1872 presidential campaign, the New York Sun, who was mad at Ames, dug up some of this material, and then this is just a partial list of the people that were involved in it. Oaks Ames, Massachusetts representative, James Brooks, James A. Garfield. Well, let's elect him president. What the heck? We know he knows how to make business and make money. So he got to be president. If you saw the movie Lincoln, Schuyler Colfax at that point was Speaker of the House, and he cast a vote. They had him cast a vote, which they usually didn't do, the Speaker, until unless it was a tie. So Schuyler Colfax was a vice president. They pulled him off once his name was on this. And they put in Henry Wilson, and of course Henry Wilson was really a great guy. He became vice president in the second term. So it didn't seem to have too much of an effect on anybody except Ames and Brooks were the ones that seemed to hit the hardest. Ames went home very quickly after this and had a stroke and died very shortly afterward. So the success that the Ames had on the national scene really ended up in failure in many of the cases. Going over just a couple of these places quickly now, this is where the flume ran in. The flume actually was, this is where the supports were for it. The flume would have been up at a higher level like this because the dam behind it. The little falls, you can usually see one rock sticking up if you go around the corner here. And this is on the walk that you can take to that area. Wait till the snow gets off the ground. Take a walk up there, it's really quite nice. And here's the rocks that you see, and I didn't get a picture of the bricks in there, but I do know that that they're still visible there. This is the area where the roundhouse was, and the other buildings that we talked about were back over in here, just alongside the road. It is a Gilded Age, and one of the things that the robber barons did in the Gilded Age was to build castles, and that was a big thing in the Gilded Age, led into the cottage era around here, especially up in Stockbridge and Lenox, where a lot of those buildings are still standing. So Mark Hopkins, a little gal from Great Barrington, wanted a bigger house, and he had a small house when he stayed there, so he built her a nice place, and that house stood until the 1906 earthquake.
Where?
And down it came. This was on Knob Hill in San Francisco. And it stood until the earthquake, and if you go there now, you can go to the top of the Mark, if you've heard of the top of the Mark, or if you've been there, and that's the Mark Hopkins Hotel, and that's still standing there. That's named for him, and there's some of the other buildings that are still around, too. Now, Hopkins died in 1878. He was the first one to die, and he died in 1878. He was going by train down in Arizona. And his health hadn't been too good, and but he had been questioned about the Credit Mobilia, wondering if there was any thing to do with the Central Pacific. And he said, "I'd like to help you," he said, "but as soon as we finish the job, we burned all the records. So you know, what can we do?" So you draw your own conclusions. I don't think they had anything to do with it, but the records were burned. Whether that was necessary or not, I don't know. Now, if we take take Mark Hopkins, and now his bride is his widow, and they go back to Great Barrington, and she falls in love with the guy that becomes a decorator on her new house, which we still have remains of that, of course, around. And Cyril's Castle is built with Mark Hopkins money. When he died, he left her somewhere, and you can't find the accurate records on this, somewhere between $20 and $50 million. And that's 1878. And if you that would be worth probably about 19 times as much now. So, I mean, these guys really did very well in the railroad business. Another,
I
tried to get a shot without cars, but I couldn't get that. But this is quite a building. I've never been through
it's
that.
On it's on sale
it's,
now
it's for sale, days. Yes. I understand it dropped a little bit yesterday. We're going to take up collection at the end. We need I think it's $8.5 million, Mary. Mary's going to handle it, so we'll make something on that. Then I'll burn the records. Interesting. Interesting, down in West Cornwall, just by the railroad track, there's this little church, the chapel. And it is now a residence, but that was built with money from Hopkins.
Oh, really?
Ted Hopkins, Huntington. Huntington built that, and he built a chapel. If you go up the hill on Route 4 in Harwinton, there's a big church on the left-hand side, the Congregational Church. He built a chapel to go with that. And later on, it was torn down. He wasn't a favorite any longer in that town, apparently. And if you go in the parking lot there now, there's a nice memory of his mother that's been put there. But he built this. He didn't build it, but he contributed very heavily to this. And that was 1878, 1877, in that period when he and his wife were both back.
I think it was 1875.
1875? I'll accept it. That's easier than a name. Only picture I've ever seen of the Upper Falls area, the Little Falls area, and with not much explanation go with it, but you've got a good 12 to 13 feet in here, plus they would probably have flashboards up there, so maybe 15 feet altogether, so it would have provided a pretty good head for the water coming through that area. Then J. Henry Rohrbach, 1913, putting in the new dam in this area. You can't see it too well in that picture. And then the way the dam is today with the wall that was put up here in 1851, and they ran the water through it. It's going to be like the system up in Holyoke, Mass., and it leaked, as you probably know. And all that stands there now in this period in the whole area, that any sign of industry is what you see here, which is the power company. And if I got this right, that's all, folks. Thank you.